First of all, we are in a series entitled Order. 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 We're in a series entitled Order. Say that, order.
Order.
Not so much about what time we start church or what you should wear, where you ought to sit. All of that's important. All protocol is important, but protocol changes depending upon where you are. And all that's good, but my particular strain or the vein that I want to move in is how we conduct ourselves with one another.
Right. That's good, sir.
I can change the way the church look. I could change the church time. I could change the church time next week and don't tell you and tell you that the church starts at 10, but really starts at 11, then everybody would be here early. You got it? But I'm more concerned in some other stuff that I want to talk to you about today that I think is going to help you not only in a church setting, but in your entire life. So I want you to apply this word. I want you to think. I don't want you to think I'm right over here. I don't want you guys to think that this is for someone else. This is for everyone. And if the word doesn't apply to you right now, just file it. Store it up for the off season. You may be on now, but there's an off season where you know you're gonna need to pull out this word and be able to utilize it for the days to come. Let's give God praise. Amen. Store it up for the off season. 1 Corinthians 14:40 says this, King James Version, let all things be done decently and in order. You may have your seats.
Good word, doctor.
Good, sir.
I want to talk this morning about house manners. House manners. We dealt with house rules and the cuss word of the church, authority. Our number one authority is God's word.
Amen.
We talked about conscience. We're going to get in a little bit about that, that God puts his word even above his name. Amen. And you really can't shout about that if you don't know anything about his name.
That's right.
Jews in that particular time wouldn't even mention his name in public. Come on, say amen.
Amen.
His name was so powerful, so rich, so reverent that they wouldn't use his name frivolously. Come on, say amen. Even in the name of Jesus, or at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Can 10 people shout amen?
Amen.
I told you the very first message of this series that each natural house has its own rules, has its own structure, and its own setup. I also told you that it's essential for you to be a productive member of that house. You have to know house rules.
That's right.
And we talked about the authority of God, his exalted word above his name, the eternal referee, the conscience that leads us in the right direction,
come on,
the Holy Spirit that will lead and guide you to all truth.
Yeah.
Our peace level, we talked about that, is an indicator as to whether or not we are in the right. But this morning, I want to talk to you about another element of living effectively in the house.
Talk, sir.
I will refer again back to the natural house to illustrate some things. To be a productive, blessed, covered member of my natural house, and in order to be able to sit without any pain, you had to abide by house manners. Shout house manners. In other words, there were certain things that I had to do and I could not do in my house. Let me give you some examples. I couldn't talk with my mouth full. That was considered rude. And oftentimes, you know me, I get excited. I be at dinner and I'm talking and food flying. And my wife one time pulled me up when I got home. She said, you got to stop talking with food in your mouth. People don't say nothing, but you talking and food flying on them. It's embarrassing. I said, yes, baby, I'll work on that. Secondly, I couldn't call grown folks by their first name.
Right.
Yep. Anybody was raised like me? We had to preface their address with Mr. or Mrs. Miss Rose. So come on, say amen. We had to preface them. We didn't be disrespectful to our elder people. I got some cousins right now, you watch it, used to call their mama by their first name. I don't even call none of my aunts and uncles by their first name. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Those were just our house managers. Man, oh, manners. This is a biggie, Crystal. I had to open the door for a woman.
Amen.
Y'all didn't say that. Maybe y'all wasn't raised like me. My mother had a problem with that. House managers or house manners. Manners are defined, it's on the screen, as social conduct or rules of conduct. Say that with me, keep it on the screen. Social. Come on, you're in class. Or rules. One more time. Say it like you see it.
Social conduct or rules of conduct.
Thank you so much. Y'all, great, great class this morning. House manners. What I want you to know and understand this morning, Sheena, is that in God's house, there are also house manners that we must learn and abide by. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, mind your manners. Tell them, mind your manners. So Paul William, listen to me, addressed house manners when he deals with the church in Corinth. Their worship service were marked by confusion and chaos, the Corinthian church, and he reminds them to mind their manners.
Yeah.
Look at our text again, verse 40. Let all things be done decently and in order. Let's say that together. Come on.
Let all things be done decently and in order.
Say that one more time.
Let all things be done decently and in order.
I give God praise for the word.
Just
want you to know I'm not making this up. Even 1 Timothy, Paul writes to his understudy in verse 15, chapter 3. I'll be reading New International Version. He says this, if I am delayed, you would know how people ought to conduct themselves in God's household, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and foundation of the truth. And the people of God say, I wish I could really work that. Don't have a lot of time because everybody put everything before the church. And it's the pillar out of which everything you ought to do operates. Come on, say amen. If you let the church be your pillar, your business will be your bed. You didn't get it. I'm not going to stay there. Now, how could I preach about manners? I can preach about God's manners or manners about God's house for weeks. I could deal with how our worship services ought to be conducted or supported. I can deal with how we respond to the government in the church. However, I want to sort of tune in on the manners that deal with how we interact with each other. I think that's important, don't you? I'm persuaded that that's important. I'm convinced that how we treat and conduct ourselves to one another is extremely important because Jesus says they would know who we are or know that you are my disciples by how we love each other. Not how much money you have, not how much property you have, not how well you can preach, not how well you can pray, say amen somebody, not how long you've been in church. It's how we love, how we treat one another. Here it is, even when we're going through with one another. It's easy to treat you right when things are going right, but how much more I ought to treat you when things are not going as I expected them to go. That's the true mark of a Christian, not how I act, but how I react, how I respond, how I conduct myself when I feel like I'm being annoyed. Have I got a witness here? Because I've discovered that if we treat each other with manners, then treating God with manners is almost a given. So the first manner, y'all ready?
Yes, sir.
It's on the screen. Shout this out. Number one, regard. Say that, regard. That's a manner. A manner. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16, New International Version. It's on the screen. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer.
Amen.
And the people of God says amen.
Amen.
When the scripture is read, somebody ought to holler, amen.
Amen.
That's our manner in this house. Come on, say amen. Because the word is power. If I don't say anything else, you ought to shout amen about the word. Let's look at that same scripture. New Living Translation. I'm going to give you another opportunity to say amen. It's on the screen. So we have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. Get this. Put on your thinking caps. At one time, we thought of Christ merely from a human point of view. How differently we know him now.
Amen.
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 Amen. Listen to what Paul says here, little kitty. He says, tell them, listen, he says, we view Christ by where he came from. I can stop right there and preach a lie, because you remember the Daniel says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Y'all remember that? The reason why they couldn't believe God could do anything, because they looked at God as where they came from. Watch this. What his idiosyncrasies were. Endosyncrasies were. Or what was bothering us. His annoying traits. And we missed who he was. Y'all remember when he went back to his hometown? He couldn't do any miracles. And he stated this statement that hurts my heart today, that a prophet has no honor in his own home. And the saddest two words I hear in the Bible was he left his own hometown. He was a star, raising the dead, opening up deaf ears and blind eyes. And when he went back home, watch this, to help his hometown, he couldn't do no miracles there but a couple healings, because the people saw him as common. They viewed him, watch this, in a natural standpoint, and they missed God in the flesh. Man, so now if watch this, but he says we had to learn, Paul said, we had to learn to regard him after the spirit. Watch this, and discovered he was God in the flesh. Now, if they had to learn to do that with Christ, how much more do we have to do that with one another? If the disciples, watch this, Jason, had to get past the fact that Jesus was born to a carpenter, watch this, in Nazareth, if they had to get past the fact that he failed the test in the fourth grade, if they had to get past the fact that he had a pimple every now and then, that should teach us, watch this, or they should, watch this, understand who he really was, and it should teach us that we have to look deeper into one another.
Yeah.
The first house manner is that we no longer regard one another after the flesh. This ain't going to be a lot of hollering. Now, what does that mean? That means when I look at you, I don't see your fleshly traits that bother me. I'm gonna work this, I promise you. You might as well get with me, because it ain't getting no better than this. This is grown up talk right now. Now, if you still a child and you can't get past people's traits and you still holding on what they used to be, you can excuse yourself right now, because this message gonna irritate the hell out of you. I'm talking about literally the hell out of you. Watch this. I make a conscious choice to look past the human traits, the stuff that drives me crazy, the hang-ups, the habits, your past, but instead I have to make up in my mind to look deep inside of you to see the Jesus in you. It's going to get really good. The louder you get, the more I know you understand. I don't regard you after what or who you used to be. Tell somebody, I'm not what I used to be. And in fact, you better thank God I'm not what I used to be.
Thank you, Jesus. God.
I think one of the problems why we can't accept people where they are now, because you got too many expectations on them.
That's right. That's right.
Tell somebody, I'm not what I used to be. And many times we judge people over what and how they used to do stuff, but tell somebody, I've changed a little bit. God worked on me. Give me some credit. I know I got a track record. I know I got an MO. But just like God changed you, he can change me. I'm going to help. I promise you, when you put your thinking caps with this message, you will no longer look at people in the flesh. Because when you look at people in the flesh, you might miss your next message. From the people you annoy, maybe the person may bless you.
Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus.
They miss Jesus. Because where he come from and who they thought he was. And all the time, he was God in the flesh. Do you not know you can miss your destiny? Watch this. By avoiding somebody you think you know. Let me take my time. Y'all push me too well. I don't regard you after what or who you used to be. I called my sister the other day, and I was trying to get her to help me to do something. And I said, I'm not going to give you this because you don't follow through. She said, stop doing that. That's how I used to be. And all I want to tell you is, don't tell nobody else. Don't give me a piece of paper because I'm a loser. That's how I used to be. Y'all quiet. Don't tell me I'm not a good administrator. 12 years has taught me something. I'm not the same pastor 2006. If you look at me now, like I was 2006, you will miss God. You will miss your hookup. Because the day you mess around and give me a piece of paper, I may mistake it as some money and return and give you $1,000. So keep your paper. Keep your paper.
Jesus.
You miss your cue to shout. I don't regard you after what or who you used to be. That means your ugly past doesn't determine whether or not, hear me, church, I will hang around you or not. No. I'm about to wipe this totally out of our church. Don't mind your business, mind your manners. Your business is the church. Can't mind your business. You got it, baby. You already in my clothes. Don't let that come out of your mouth again in this church. Mind your manners. If you can handle your manners, you can. You don't have to mind your business. Tell somebody, that's not who you are anymore. That's not who you are anymore. We're going to get a transformation through our thinking today. All this stuff that's in this church about how people used to be, you need to get over it, because we got to get over your stuff. So I don't regard you by what abilities or talents I think you have or don't have. Listen, I regard you after the spirit that's in you. Get it now? What does that mean? Come here, Tracy. Wherever she is. Don't come here, but come here. I can no longer look at an usher and think they're just an usher. We went down on Pennsylvania the other week, and I had to preach. And the bishop does not know Tracy at all. Am I right about it? And pulled her up and said, God is going to bless you because you are, it's better to stand at the gate of the door than to wear a title. Something like that. Don't quote me wrong. And he says, and he didn't even know that she was an usher. So our church started shouting. And he says, you cover your pastor. Because he just didn't look at her as an usher, but he saw her as an intercessor. And then when you start looking at people in the eyes of God, you'll see more than who they are. I think y'all would shout, because some of y'all didn't make it down Philadelphia, but those of y'all that was in Pennsylvania know what I'm talking about. Pulled her out of the crowd when all the hell was going on in our church. And says, you more than an usher. Y'all think I'm blind, but I'm telling you. Here it is. Be careful because the spirit in them may have something to contribute to my life. Taylor, I can't see you as just a singer. The spirit inside of you, I wrote this specifically for you. When I was right by that, I put your name. Want to see your name? I'll show it to you later. The spirit inside of you may have a word that will change my life. But if I look at you only as a singer, I may miss my next direction. We lock people in what we think they ought to be. Because people, watch this, and it's dangerous, don't want you to move further than them. Trickery gets in a place when they think you're going farther than them. But when you regard people, when you make it, already made. Because we connected. Come on, say amen. I'm on your side. I'm pushing you till you're doing better than me. See the revelation of this passage. I know I'm not going to get a lot of likes, but if you're watching, somebody need to hear this, and maybe in your church, just share it. The revelation of this passage and the importance of learning this manner. Watch this. I worked hard for this. Listen to this. Y'all ought to pay me. I worked hard. I wrote this down. The revelation of this passage about this regard piece, this manner, is that now I can't allow the stuff about you naturally that I don't like cause me to avoid or dislike you, because the result is I could forfeit the impact you may have been assigned to have in my life. I can't avoid you because I don't like you. God may put the treasure in you for me. And I'm avoiding you going to people I like, and they don't have nothing that I need. God will hide the treasure in somebody you don't like, and watch you avoid them, and somebody else get blessed by them, and you sit back mad. Oh, you mad. Oh, you mad for real. You need to get over your mad. Find that person that you dislike, because most likely they got your piece to your puzzle. That's why sometimes when you see people who don't get along in the beginning, they find themselves getting hooked up. Come on, say amen. Because God, some kind of way, hooked that thing up, because the identification is most people don't like you because they see you in them. Y'all quiet. They see identification. And that thing they don't like about them is what they don't like about you. But the devil is a liar. And we regard people after the spirit and not after the flesh. We become better and not bitter. I thought I wasn't going to holler, but I had it right there. Let me ask you this. What if your destiny is right? don't like? Let me play that one more time. What if your destiny is wrapped up in somebody you don't like? So you avoid your destiny by avoiding them. Is that worth it? Are you really spiritual? Maybe the reason why you're not moving as fast as you desire is because you're avoiding somebody God like. You don't like what God like. That's a shame. Oh, you mad. You mad. They mad. All right. I get that credit applied. Get all that implied. But I ain't gonna say no B-I-H, I ain't saying. Y'all know he say that too, with his crazy self. Y'all mad? You mad over what? When you slice it up for real, you mad over what for real though? I mean, what's the purpose? Who gonna benefit from you being mad? You aren't even gonna benefit from being mad. Do you know being mad keeps you in bondage? Let me tell you how to get unmad. Go to the person that you're mad with. Is that it? That's it to you? Is that it? Can y'all agree with that? Well, here's where you put in your thinking cap. Who am I mad at? Because for real though, you're mad. What if you miss God? Because you choose to regard someone after their flesh rather than their spirit. What if you only think, I can only give your word because you regard me differently than you regard the children's church worker because of a title? Wow. Desiree, I wrote this for Desiree, she ain't even here, may give you a word how to keep your husband interested. All these niggas in Israel. Or show you how to get one and stop running with everybody else's. Because right now you got somebody in mind that you mad at. But guarantee you, somebody mad at you. And they got to do the same thing that you're doing for them, for you. So don't forget that. Let me plug that in. You ain't all in the clear. You hurt somebody too. You offensive too. You fall short too. And maybe it's them today, but it may be you when. Tomorrow. Don't forget the same grace. Watch this. You need. You better extend it. Blessed are the merciful, for they may obtain mercy. I don't know about you, but I came in this morning because I need mercy. You don't want to clap, I clap for myself. I woke up this morning because of mercy, because he didn't give me what I deserve. I said he didn't give me what I deserve. Y'all don't know what to shout. Let me walk out here. You ought to thank God he didn't give you what you deserve. Grace is God giving me what I don't deserve. Mercy is God not giving me what I do deserve. I deserve. Watch this. To go to hell. But God, who is rich in mercy, wherewith he loved us with this great love. We are saved by grace through faith. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest. I love this church. This is a Bible church. We have to look past stuff in you to see Jesus. So you got to look past stuff in them to see Jesus. Tell somebody, I ain't all that. I'm at all. At any given day,
sir,
I can grow a top.
Any given day.
Don't you never think you arrive. Jesus said, take heed, lest you fall. Don't never think that you're that secure in your faith and you're stable and mature now. God will test you with stuff that's important to you. And you'll start looking at people all in a different way. When for real, your problem. Thank you, recovery. Your problem starts with you and ends with you. Your problem ain't him. Your problem is you. I don't care how many degrees you have. I don't care when you go to college. I don't care who raised you. You have to deal with you. When you lay down at night, it's just you. And you have to take an evaluation of who you are. Did I do the best today? If we were God and learned this manner, you guys, three things would happen. Number one, we would treat people better. It's not on the screen. Number two, we would see more Jesus around us. And number three, the playing field would be level because titles wouldn't matter anymore. Wouldn't matter anymore.
Amen.
Titles wouldn't matter anymore when you regard this manner. Because you can have a title and regard people the wrong way. And let me push this envelope. Most people in our church we regard the wrong way. It's really the anointed one. Come here, Jesus. Come on, y'all. They miss who we were. Am I right about it, Jason? We regard people and don't really know who they are. So, first matter is regard. Second matter is on the screen. Let's shout this with some vigor. Respect. Regard and respect. Hey, Mike, love you, son. Look at the screen, verse 7, Romans chapter 13. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. Y'all didn't say nothing.
Amen.
Three amens out of 50.
Amen.
Well, that's good. That's better. No, that ain't even 10%. Let's look at it in the New Living Translation. Give it to everyone.
Yeah.
What you owe them. Mm-hmm. Pay your taxes and government fees to those who collect them. And give respect and honor to those who are in authority and the people of God.
Amen.
I have an announcement and a declaration this morning, Liberty House. This house will operate on honor. Some of y'all got your tongue, ain't saying nothing. Let me regurgitate that again. Liberty House, this house will operate on honor.
Amen.
That was a general statement. Not general in plain, but a general. Those that deserve honor will be honored. We should go out of our way to honor those who labor among us. You want to get on my nerves? Dishonor someone who is working as a volunteer, who gives freely of their time, arrives early, and stays late. You want to get on my nerves? Dishonor them. We should honor them. Worship team doesn't get paid. We should honor them. Children workers don't get paid. We should honor them. Ushers don't get paid. We should honor them. Greeters that's coming from north, south, east, and west don't get paid. We should honor them. Sound techs don't get paid. We should honor them. Media techs, camera operators, get paid sometime. But we should honor them. Paid staff, unpaid staff, if they're in the house of God and they are working, they ought to be honored. Persons opening every week, don't get paid. We should honor them. Elders and ministers and deacons don't get paid. We should honor them. Drummers and keyboard players get paid. We should honor them. It's biblical to give to your Levite. Because for real, they ought not be working a job. They ought not work a full-time job and be a Levite. Because in the Israel culture, Levites didn't have an inheritance to the Israelites. They were supposed to be in the temple. They were Levites. Some of you will argue. Look how quiet y'all got. Another message. I'll tell you about it later.
Okay.
And the list goes on and on. We should mind our manners and honor these folks.
Amen.
I shouldn't have to tell you to honor me.
Amen.
That's not even. If I'm your father, where's my honor?
Amen.
I shouldn't have to do that. You know that.
Yeah.
But there's some other people in here that you don't honor. Yeah. And you look at them like they don't mean anything. But you run up in my face like I got your answers. You run right past your answer to shake my hand. Because you don't honor them. Because they don't have a title. around and shake my hand.
Jesus.
Like my hand or my hug gonna change your life. Then you hug me this week, then I get on your nerve next week. Because I'm not your pastor, I'm your preacher.
Wow.
we trade fathers in the gospel like tricks trade tricks. Let me run by you again. We trade spiritual parents in the gospel like tricks trade tricks. If I'm your father and you don't like what I'm doing or done, I'm not your father no more. I have a biological father. There's some things that I can't stand either. I can't go get another. How much more? God says in order to see the supernatural, you need to look in the natural. Romans 1:20. Right? So I'm trying to give you an illustration. The minute you don't, you go find another father, okay, you don't like the ministry, you go somewhere in another country, but you only got one, I only got one spiritual father.
One.
Because I don't like what he's doing, so my DNA changed now.
Right.
All of a sudden, because I don't feel what he's doing, I got a different DNA. No, that's fickle.
Yep.
That's fickle. If you call, why are you calling me dad, if you don't like what I do now, I'm pastor? I'm preacher? No, I'm. And I got to honor my dad whether I like it or not because it's my dad. I'm a pastor now because you don't like what I do. Or the decisions that I make, I'm not dad no more, I'm Reverend Owens. Even if you leave the church, you don't leave your dad. If I'm your dad, you go to Africa on a mission trip, they keep you over there. Your dad here.
Yes, sir.
If I'm your dad, if not, just stop faking. Just call me Oles. So dad today ain't your dad tomorrow because I ain't feeling what you're doing. We got to get it right. No honor. And the majority of the time, you don't like it because you don't understand it.
Yeah.
Because God ain't gave it to you.
Yeah.
So it hurts your flesh.
Yeah.
Because you can't hurt a dead man.
Yeah.
When my feelings get hurt, it hurt my flesh. Because if I'm dead to my flesh and ain't in my flesh, you can't hurt me, right? Am I your dad? Because where's my honor? You get mad at me and duck me.
My God.
Until you need me.
That's right.
Wow. To bury you or marry you. This manner should trickle down into all of our relationships. If we honor one another, we will act out on Romans 12:10, New Living Translation on the screen. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. We shouldn't have to jock for position or place if we honor or prefer one another.
Amen.
This trickles down into our homes. We are instructed to honor our parents. The first command with a promise. In fact, young people, if you hear me today, the Bible says that this will determine how long you live. Husbands, respect your wives and treat them with dignity. Wives, respect husbands, and he will live up to your honor.
Wow.
So the first manner is regard. 11:32, great time. Manner number two, respect. One, regard. Third, on the screen, resolve.
Resolve.
One of the biggest problems in all churches in America is conflict resolution.
Come on, sir.
Let me slow down so I can penetrate this well.
Employment.
Matthew 18, 15, 20. It's on the screen. Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him
alone.
Y'all see that?
Right.
If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained that brother. That's your purpose of going to them to gain them. Not to get it off your little chest. You so petty and mad. Here's your prescription. Here's your resolve. Here's how you fix problems. Don't wait for them to go to you. Go to them. They ain't speaking to you. Speak to them. But if we, or if he will not hear thee, then take him with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he will or shall neglect to hear them, tell it unto the church. But if he neglected to hear the church, let him be unto thee as a heathen man and a public. Some of y'all ain't got nowhere near that. You ain't even gone to the person yet. That's the third resolve, but you ain't gone to the first one yet. You still holding resentment. Verily I say to you, there you go. That got to be Chris, bad man. Whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching in anything they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst. And the people of God said, amen. That was good. Resolve. Let me put it in the New Living Translation. Yeah, I made all these slides just for y'all. It's on the screen. If another believer sins against you, go privately and point out the offense. That means don't go to everybody else and tell everybody else about your offense. The minute you do that, you are in error, and you're the blame. Come on, say amen. Y'all see that? Go privately and point out the offense. If the other person listens and confesses it, you have won that person back. The reason you go and tell that person is to win them back. But you got to be spiritual to do that. You can't be in your flesh to do that. Your feelings hurt so bad, you want to retaliate. That ain't love. Love does not retaliate. Love wins. Come on, say amen. I said love wins. Going back on in. If the person still refuses to listen, take your case to the church. Then if she or she won't accept the church's decision, treat that person as a pagan or a corrupt tax collector. Amen. I tell you the truth, whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven. You can't get these blessings until you do that first. You loosen and binding and all that and got a problem with your brother. Now keep that to yourself. I bind, no, you ain't binding nothing. Bind yourself and go fix your relationship. In the name of you, do no. I don't want your gift, I don't want your worship, I don't want nothing. Tell you go back and fix it with your brother. In other words, shut up. Be quiet. Hold your peace. Don't preach. Don't pray. Don't give. Tell you the truth, whatever. I also tell you this. Two of you agree here on earth, concerning anything you ask, my Father in heaven will do it for you. For where two or three gathered together, as my followers, I'm there among them. Man, that's so good. I know I have read at least this first part of this to you a numerous of times. And nobody here been around me long enough don't know that scripture. I say it all the time. Am I right? I continue to read it and quote this passage to you because there isn't much that shocks me anymore. I've seen a lot of things. Crazy things, scary things, weird things. However, the one thing that still shocks me when I deal with Christians and God's house is the number of unresolved relationships in the church.
My God.
Yes. I see some crazy stuff, but this right here, unresolved relationships. Unresolved relationships. Because the parties are immature. Because when you're mature, you follow what you know. And we avoid people because something is wrong with us. We will leave a church, yeah, I wrote this, rather than staying and minding our manners. Don't stay and mind your business, but stay and mind your manners. It's a difference. Are y'all getting this? I wish I had some noise there. We will leave a church, or if we won't leave the church, we will literally avoid people for years. I've seen it. Not only in this church, I've been in church, man, all my life. I'm talking about all my life. My mama raised me in church. I'm 53 in September. I got 53 experience with church people.
My God.
I've been pastoring 11 years, but I've been in church for 53 years.
My Lord.
They would stay in the same church and avoid each other for years. Go to a service. Sit on the other side of the room and hold secret grudges. And never deal with them. That's unhealthy. My question is, why are you still here? With the grudge. Listen, I can't be in a place and be in a, I got to deal with it. I got to pull somebody up to help. We got to stop this. We got to pray. It's bigger than me and you. The kingdom is stronger than our relationship. We got to fix it. We ain't going to leave it today. I'm not going to worship another. Y'all not saying
that. That's right. All good, sir.
We going to fix this today. I'm not going back home with you in my mind.
That's right.
Because if you in my mind, eventually you're going to get in my mouth.
That's right.
Y'all quiet here. So I'm going to fix it today to keep me from getting in my flesh. I'm going to mind my manners. I'm going to honor you enough to pull you up. I'm going to respect you enough. I'm going to regard you enough to let you know what we're going through is too petty. It's too small. We got too much to cover. People are dying and going to hell, and we fighting in the church. Look at Proverbs 20, verse 3, New International Version. It is to one's honor to avoid strife, but every fool is quick to quarrel. There are a lot of houses that must be full with fools. Because they'll fight at the drop of a hat. I can't hit nobody.
Amen.
I know you haven't attended none of those churches before, but listen, worship won't make the grudge go away.
No.
Lift up your hands all you want.
Yeah.
Holler and scream and slide, do carpet ministry all you want. You on this side screaming, hollering, and crying and can't stand the neighbor on the other side of the church. That's confusing.
Yeah.
That's missed messages.
Yes,
can I call it like I see it? You got a demon. It's a spirit. You got a bitter, grudging spirit that needs to be cast out. And in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, I take authority over every demonic spirit that will cause relationships to be broken in the house of the God. I call you out. In Jesus' mighty name, the devil is a liar. We will overcome. because of relationship broken. Family members broken over petty history. Get over it and be the people of God. In Jesus' name, they clap your hands and give God praise. Whatever happened, it's over. It's done. Pick yourself up and keep moving. And don't mind your business, but mind your manners. How you treat people. Even when you're offended, shows how much God you got in you. Easy to treat you right when you treat me right. That's what fighting a good fight is. Praying for your enemies. Bless them that falsely persecute me. I wish I had a church in here today. Matthew 5 teaches us. Prayer won't make the relationship right. Pray, you do whatever. You have to go to that person. That's your responsibility. Now, God, give me the tenacity, the tolerance when I do go, that I don't make things worse. Give me the right door. The right timing, because in my heart I want to win my brother, because he ain't what he used to be. She ain't what she used to be. Let me get him back in the race again. Resolution must come before worship and before we pray. Let me say that again. Resolution must come before worship and before prayer. You can be in the same room and not be together. Bring together or being together isn't just geography. It's also a mentality. Let me say that again. Being together isn't just geography, but it's a mentality. Have I got a witness here? I just walked in some of your bedrooms right there. I just walked in some of your bedrooms right there. You're there geographically. But mentality, you ain't even in your own bed. You ever heard the phrase, I'm sleeping with her, but I ain't thinking about her? This adult stuff. In other words, when I'm sleeping with you, I'm thinking about somebody else. Y'all not talking now. Geographically, I'm there, but mentality, I'm at the hotel room with a fantasy. Can I help you with your crazy self?
Yes, sir. Help
me. It's just a fantasy. Make sure you wake up beside the right one. If we want God in the house, we have to be together. That's what that scripture said. When we together, touching and agreeing, ask of anything. Let me become a house. So let us become a house that refuses to fight each other. That's my prayer. Lord, make us one. But here's my part. Let's become a house that point our guns at the enemy. Why am I shooting my own soldiers? We're the only club that shoots its own soldiers. Why I got to always go on, focus on my, why am I wrestling or why am I tackling the same brother with the same jersey on? What's wrong with you? Or is it that you don't really want us to win? Do you really have a losing spirit?
Teach
why are you tackling?
Teach
why is the sinner tackling the quarterback?
Teach it, sir.
Number one, regard. Number two, respect. Number three, resolve. And lastly, we'll be done at 12. I'm going to hang out and drive around my new car anywhere I want to go. I got a twofold blessing. On the screen, shout it. Restore.
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 After you regard, what's next? After you respect, you resolve. And ultimately, man, it's about restoring. That's when God gets the joy. You want us to resolve and punish people for the rest of their life. And you cannot give me a time limit of when they ready. You are not the pastor. Go back to the other step. Honor.
Yes, sir.
And if I make the bad decision, it bites me. But if my heart wants to restore, and I know God's heart wants to restore, God going to cover me and people going to get blessed.
Amen.
Let me keep going.
Yes,
y'all don't believe that. Galatians 6:1, I'm closing now. New International Version. Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. But watch yourself, or you also could be them today. But be you tomorrow. So I gently pick my brother up, put him back in a place where they once was. Why? So God can be glorified. Grace is a mandated manner. That's a good place to write. I wish I was on Facebook. I put that on there. Grace is a mandated manner. We must become a house full of grace. The truth is, we won't always mind our manners, y'all. And we will fail to regard one another and fail to give honor what honor is due. There will be times the pastor should acknowledge someone for their sacrifice and service, and I will blow it. There will be times when you hurt my feelings and do me wrong, but this house manner allows me to stay together in the house. Somebody shout, restore.
Restore.
I'm done. I'm closing. But how do I deal with you when you get on my nerves? I mind my manners. How do I deal with you when you hurt my feelings? I mind my manners and extend grace. I want to challenge you today to mind your manners. Have you regarded individuals correctly? Have you overlooked someone who may hold your destiny in their hands? Have you honored those whom deserve honor? Have you said thank you lately? Are there unresolved conflicts in this room or in your room? You can literally keep God out if you are not together. Let's make a house full of grace. House man. Look at your name and say, I regard you. I respect you. We will resolve. And and restore. Because grace is what I need. Come on, clap your hands, standing all over the building.